Welcome to the CCFR Radio Podcast, your source for news, updates, and stories from the CCFR.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to episode 80 of the CCFR Radio Podcast. I'm your host, Rod Giltacka. Thanks for joining me again. Today's podcast brought to you, as usual, by Vortex, the power of optics. So thanks again to everyone over at Vortex Canada for not only supporting the podcast, but also renewing their sponsorship. So we really appreciate it. And this is how we can do the things that we do. Today on the show, I'm going to have Tracey Wilson come on in a little bit. We've got a lot to talk about because, oddly enough, there was a ton of firearm news in the last 3 weeks since we did a podcast. And I've just got a couple of things I want to talk to you about or alert you to before we bring Tracey on. So let's get started. First thing I want to talk about is episode 3 of Gun Ban Canada Exposed is going to be airing, I think, November 30th. So a few days from now. So make sure you check that out. You can see it on Wild TV or you can see it on the CCFR YouTube channel the day after it premieres on Wild TV, and make sure that you share it. And also let me know what you think of it, right? I mean, we're trying to solidify and amalgamate, you know, all the things that we know are true and things that are contrary to the story and sometimes the completely untrue story that the anti-gun folks in Canada are propagating and the media helps them propagate, right? So anyway, it's the latest episode 3 that premieres at the end of the month has been the most difficult episode of anything I've ever done. And the reason for that is everything in this show, if anyone ever says, well, you know, is that true? Where's your proof? How do you know that? I've actually libraried and cataloged all of every claim that we've made in the show and the backup information that proves it. And so basically for something like this, and I was going on and on in other episodes about how much work it is for me personally to do these episodes because I have to write them, perform them, research them, all that stuff. It's this one was the worst of all because every 3 lines worth of dialogue that I performed in this episode required research and for me to document that research so I could back it up. And it was so much, it just nearly killed me. But anyway, I hope you guys will enjoy it. It's whether or not more guns equal more death. And I think I've made a compelling case. So make sure that when it comes out, you share it and get people to watch it because that's the only way that makes a difference. Next thing I want to talk about is I made an appearance on the Strong and Free podcast. So this is a podcast that is hosted by a guy named Christopher Balkran. And Christopher, I think, lives in, you know, either in or just outside Toronto, so in the GTA. And, you know, it's funny because I think it was an accident that, you know, I bumped into Christopher. I think it was on Twitter somehow. But I just found him to be a really genuinely curious person and a genuine person. And he had a podcast where he actually tackled some very difficult topics like vaccines and abortion. And, you know, he's gone to gun violence and gun control. And, you know, he just approaches things in a very different way. And I always like to talk to different people. And I always like to talk to people that don't agree with me because it helps me grow. Right. So I don't know. I just thought he was very interesting. And we ended up doing that podcast together. If you go to his website for the podcast itself, it's called the Strong and Free Podcast, I believe is the website. You can search for it. I found it quite easily. And that podcast where he had me on is on iTunes, on Spotify, on Google Podcasts. It's everywhere already. It's already been propagated through those networks. So check it out and maybe look Christopher up and just see what else he's got. I find his podcast to be quite interesting. So I really appreciate that. So what I'm going to do right now is that's all I want to talk about because Tracey and I have a very long discussion coming. So stand by. I'm going to bring on Tracey. Hey, everybody. This is Rod from the CCFR. In 4.5 years, we've created the most sophisticated and influential firearm rights organization in Canadian history. And when I say we, I mean our team and all of you who have trusted and supported us financially and as volunteers. Together, we've produced television shows, made our presence very well known on Parliament Hill, and taken on the anti-gun establishment as never before. We are in unprecedented times in Canada and around the world. Our goal is to continue to develop the CCFR into an even more formidable organization to better fight for your right to own and use firearms when stability returns. If you can afford it, please continue to support the CCFR by keeping your membership current and/or donating. If you are unemployed, do not do these things. We are an organization with values, and family comes first. If you're in this situation and you still want to support the CCFR, do it by sharing our explainer videos, the podcast, our reports, or our TV show, which is now available for free online on the CCFR YouTube channel. We can come out of this stronger than ever. Look after yourself, your family, and your community. And thank you for supporting the CCFR in any way that works for you. Right on the Skype, I've got Wilson. Wilson.
Skill Taka.
All right. There's a lot to talk about, so we might as well get started right away.
Okay.
Okie dokie. So I think the first thing we want to talk about is the National Police Federation releasing a statement that is what I would consider not supportive of the diabolical gun ban.
Yeah, that's right. So the National Police Federation, which is actually Canada's largest police union, and it's actually the second largest police union in North America, released a statement yesterday, and they sent it right out through the newswire and to all media. Like, this was a huge launch. And basically, it's a position statement on the OIC gun ban, the resources and focus that it's going to detract from efforts to combat actual crime. And they've got a call to action in there. They've got a conclusion, and they're not supporting this gun ban at all. So yeah, really nice to see. So this is the union that represents over 20,000 RCMP members across the country. That's a big deal.
That's good. And of course it goes contrary to what Bill Blair says, is that, you know, chiefs of police and, you know, law enforcement supports what we've done with Bill C-71 and the May 1st gun ban.
Yeah, that's completely false. They do not support it. You know, if anybody knows, out of all the experts and people, they have come testify at committees, and, you know, you and I have both been in that seat ourselves. If anybody really knows what's going on in the world of crime and gun smuggling and all these horrible things that add to the violence in the streets across our country, these are the people who know about it. And they absolutely do not support it, not in any way possible. In fact, they're quite upset about it. They've actually been working really hard behind the scenes. I know Pete Merrifield, who is the vice president of the National Police Federation, he shared the post into our group yesterday. And you know, a couple comments like, well, where have you guys been? Because this ban happened May 1st. And it was interesting. Pete had something really profound to say. And I did share it in the website post, but I'm also going to share it with our listeners tonight. I'll read it as quickly as possible. He says, in April, I dealt with the widowed husband and two young children of one of my members who was murdered along with 21 other innocent people by a criminal with illegal firearms. And he's talking about the Nova Scotia shooting. When the ban was announced in May, I was the first person to get a meeting with the Minister of Public Safety face-to-face in June to discuss concerns with the ban and the alternatives that focused on criminals and not on citizens. By July and August, I was being filmed for documentaries and for CCFR's TV segments, educating the public on the misdirection of the ban and its futility in relation to public safety. Also in August, we commissioned the research for this policy paper on the issue. This week, I am engaged in virtual lobby sessions with 10 key members of Parliament. In December or January, I'll be appearing before the Parliamentary Public Safety Committee. As the current government failed to provide any advance notice of their OIC, I, like many citizens, am working to educate the public, parliamentarians, and undo a pointless ban that provides zero enhancement to public safety. I think adding the voices of 20,000 frontline police officers may help the cause. I don't know, man. If I had a mic right now, I'd be dropping it, because that just, you know, that just says exactly what's going on. They have had their hands full. We have to remember that, number one, they had a member die in the, you know, horribly in the Nova Scotia incident. And, you know, this has been a plague on their members, right? They're frustrated. They want to combat crime. They want to fight gun smuggling. And they've got a government that's wholly unwilling to do anything about that. So, yeah, it's pretty serious stuff.
Yeah, it's a tough one. And, you know, I'm very appreciative to Pete and the National Police Federation for that. For, like, it's not even support, right? They're just doing what they think is appropriate for them as a police agency. And I think some people misunderstand the role of the police when they either go along with a ban, like support it or oppose it. And the thing is, police typically are just like any other agency, a government agency. They're going to be like, well, if this would help, then we're for it. And that's why you see police saying, well, you know, anything that helps is appreciated. But it's, you know, people on the anti-gun side, when they see police supporting something like a registry or gun bans or whatever, it's like they don't realize, like, the police, some police, it depends who they are, right? Some police chiefs, like a Bill Blair, right? The guy is a liar. And I said that. And if they want to come after me for that, luckily in Canada, one of the defenses for defamation is you have to say something that's untrue, and I can demonstrate. And he lied right across the table at us about me, right? You remember, right?
Like,
he lies constantly. And, you know, people like, and I'll just use, I don't know this for a fact, but he has done other tyrannical things, but there are people that get into policing, and, you know, if they could put a camera in your home monitored by the police, they'd say, yeah, that helps. And if it helps, I'm for it. So, you know, most police agencies run by reasonable people, they have to go, well, okay, there's a balance there. Why are we trying to protect people? We're trying to protect people because Canada is a great place to live, or has been certainly in the past. I think it still is to some degree, you know, and we're trying to protect that. And if we destroy that, if we turn Canada into an open air prison, then we've actually failed in our job, right? We've let criminals run the country and decide what our policies are, you know, themselves. So I know that that a few people made comments about a mention of firearm registration in that statement.
Yeah. So the National Police Federation have a call to action. And of course, you know, there's four main points that they've got for that. I'll direct everybody over to the website, or they can go to the National Police Federation's website and find that link to read those four points. But the fourth point states, the NPF supports evidence-based policy changes regarding licensing, mandatory safety training, safe storage, and registry of civilian firearms that meet Canada's high standards for legal firearm ownership. So, of course, as soon as people, gun owners are super sensitive, and as soon as they saw the word registry, they, you know, they throw up their arms, oh, well, that's it, they support registry. And you know, we've got just cause to be sensitive about these things, but, you know, in pure CCFR fashion, we had one of our directors, he reached out to the NPF and asked them just to clarify. So there's a long version of the answer. You can find it on our social media. But the short version goes, the CCFR asked, does this paragraph mean that the NPF would be in support of a long gun registry? Or is it just a statement that all aspects of gun control need to be evidence-based? The NPF replied with, that all aspects of any potential changes to any form of gun control should be evidence-based and not arbitrary. So they're not putting their support towards it. They're saying all of these different gun control, you know, areas or items should be evidence-based and not arbitrary. So if there's no evidence for a registry, of course they wouldn't support it. So I just wanted to clear that up because there was a lot of kerfuffle about that. And I understand as soon as you put that word in there, it's sort of, it's like getting needles in the eyes, right? It hurts everybody. But the other point I wanted to make too is there's some disgruntled people, rightly so, saying, well, you know, the RCMP have been adding guns to the ban by FRT changes and doing this. And I want everyone to understand there's a huge difference between brass, and especially at the Canadian Firearms Program, or the Firearms Lab, it's been run by Murray Smith for decades, right? And the boots to the ground officers. So the boots to the ground officers are not running around adding guns to the gun ban. That, of course, is being done by bureaucrats, right? So boots to the ground officers is who this union represents. And those are the people, literally boots to the ground. Who would know what's going on. They're in the front line.
Well, I appreciate the fact that they went out of their way and took political risk to say that the gun ban wasn't needed, and it's a waste of their time and a waste of resources. So, the National Police Federation looks after the interests of police, right? They're not sitting here thinking about, well, how can we help the gun lobby, right? So I'm grateful for what they did say. And I think this is also kind of a good opportunity to talk about registration, right? Because that's always a big argument. And I think a lot of people out there that even are non-gun owners, they don't understand why gun owners are so sensitive and, about registration and oppose it so much. When it comes to registering firearms, right? Handguns have been registered since 1934 in Canada. We've seen that, handguns have not, are still the number one tool of choice for firearm-related homicide in Canada. So the registry doesn't look like it's doing too good of a job. But at the same time, the police are able to trace some guns if they haven't had the serial numbers ground off to a point where they can't be recovered. So if you were to ask a series of questions, you might be like, can you trace firearms via a registry? And the answer is yes, you can. Is that useful to police if they were to find guns and for them to either get those guns back to the rightful owners or find out if a firearm owner was not being accountable for his firearms? Well, yeah, right. It can be useful. Does it help police when they go to homes, right? That was a big claim back in the long gun registry days. It's like, well, we want to know what people have. And it doesn't help at all because you don't look at the firearm registry, long gun registry, and they go, oh, there's no guns in this house. I'll just leave my gun here in the car and go to the door. Like, that's not a reality, right? And they try to say that it was, and of course it isn't. Does it save lives? Absolutely not. It does not save lives because you can never be sure who's got what anyway. There's lots of illegal guns. There's 20 million guns floating around in Canada, right? There's a lot of guns here. Does the government and the RCMP use registries to confiscate guns? And the answer is absolutely yes. And that's a real problem. Mass confiscation is a problem, right? Mm-hmm. We don't want that to be done to us. Has the government abused the long gun registry and other registries? Absolutely they have. They've done it literally thousands of times. And and that's not an inflated number. It's literally thousands of times. When they brought the registry in, and that was before my time, apparently they were like, okay, well, gun owners, we just want to know what you have. Don't be conspiracy theorists. We're not banning anything. We just want to know where all the guns are. So just register them. Well, people registered guns and then they started reclassifying them. They waited till the point where they thought, we probably got 40% registered. So we'll throw the switch. And they started reclassifying firearms from non-restricted or restricted to prohibited. And then they knew exactly where to go get them. They've betrayed gun owners and lied to them for decades in Canada, right?
So 100%, yeah.
Do gun owners trust the RCMP and the government with a registry? Absolutely not. And they have all the justification in the world not to. And I think this is, this latest gun ban is a perfect example. What registries do is they turn people like me and you into political pawns, into fodder to be shot out, for political reasons. So, Trudeau takes over. Everything was fine before Trudeau showed up. Trudeau shows up and he's like, I'm getting eaten alive by all these scandals, some of the biggest, most monstrous scandals in the history of the country. Here's how I'm going to change a channel. I'm going to ban a bunch of guns, or I'm going to roll out Bill C-71, pardon me. And so, when it came to the latest gun ban, it's like, well, here's a guy in Nova Scotia, didn't have any legal guns, doesn't matter. Now what I'm going to do is change the channel on my own scandals, and I'm going to use this as an opportunity, and I'm going to take Rod and Tracy's guns, Rod over in Vancouver on the other side of the country, because the AR-15s, they're registered. I know where they are. I know he's got them, and we're just going to go get them. And so that's what I'm using the registry for. I know Rod's not a threat, but that's okay. It doesn't matter. I need to change a channel. And that is a real problem. That is a real problem. And people don't take it seriously. It's a serious problem. So you know, just like anything else in life, registries, firearm registration, it's messy, right? There's some good. Yeah, absolutely. And there's a lot bad. And, you know, if we had a right to own firearms, a codified right, and they said, well, listen, we can never, it's codified. We can never take these guns away from you, but we want to make sure that nobody's straw purchasing. And, you know, you can use your guns wherever it's safe to discharge them and all the rest of that stuff. If the system was reasonable, you wouldn't have this big fight and you wouldn't have people digging their heels in. Right. But they've made such a mess of it and have become such deceptive, untrustworthy people and treated gun owners so badly. That's why gun owners have their heels dug in. And it's really hard for people that don't know all the backstory to understand that.
Yeah, 100%. I get people say that to me all the time. Well, what's the problem? Why would you object to this? Right. Do you have something to hide? And that's exactly it. It's been abused literally thousands of times. That's the problem.
What's the problem? Why don't you want to carry three more pieces of paper? I'm like, well, why do you want me to carry them? Well, why don't you want to carry them? I'm like, what
are you trying to hide, Giltaka?
Yeah. If people are being shot, figure out who's shooting them and go grab them, put them in jail forever or kick them right out of the country if they're not citizens. End of story, right? Take the people that are doing the bad things and do bad things to them. Right.
Yeah.
Imprison them, you know, like it's just wild. It's like, no. That's the last person we want to be messing around with is the perpetrator. Right. We want to make sure that everybody.
World.
Oh, yeah. It's upside down world. Mm-hmm. Exactly. And this is why, again, I know I'm repeating myself and I've gone on about this, but it's important things for people to understand. But this is why you get no cooperation, because you've abused the hell out of us so bad. You've destroyed the relationship if there was one there in the first place. All right. Anyway, well, I went off a little bit. Hey,
that happens. You know,
God, hey. These people.
I know. We just.
And when I say these people, I mean me for even bringing it up.
I know. No, but it is a good conversation to have. And people who aren't, you know, aren't in our community don't really understand why the history of why we get upset about that. But yeah.
Well, and this is all these things are why we can't have a reasonable discussion. And I don't want to go off on another tangent. I mean, I'm not really digressing because it's all related, but you know, the anti-gun side, you know, they don't want to have a discussion. And it's like, well, and they're unreasonable. So if you want people to be reasonable, it's almost like you got to tear up the paper and start fresh. You have to sit down and say, okay, hold on. We have a problem. You know, who are the stakeholders in these problems? How can we, you know, and people need to start over because there's a lot of history there. And
there
that's
is,
what
but
people
that,
don't understand.
That's assuming that both sides have a common goal. If we were both working towards, you know, a reduction in violence and misery in this country, then yes, that would be exactly how we could start having a conversation. But I'm of the opinion that our side is looking for a reduction in violence and their side is looking for a reduction in firearms ownership. So we're not in the same war here. So
yeah. Well, it's tough. And obviously, I think we all want a reduction in violence because, you know, violence is, you know, it's very disruptive to our society for sure. But it's not like, oh, we're going to stop violence at all costs. So everyone wears an ankle bracelet. Like, come on, man.
No, exactly. You know?
So anyway, we got to move on. So there was a memo released about what Trudeau and Blair knew and when they knew it when it came to the Nova Scotia shooting.
Speaking of abusive governments.
Rampage, not shooting.
Right. So speaking of abusive governments, it has been discovered through an ATIP that there was a memo given from the RCMP. It was a briefing memo to the Prime Minister and his team April 24th. So April 24th, the Prime Minister was advised, I've read the memo, he was advised, there were no legal firearms used in the rampage by the by Wortmann. He was not a licensed gun owner. They knew all of this April 24th, a full week ahead of the May 1 gun ban. So it's interesting because they went ahead with their May 1 gun ban and the timing matches up perfectly. Everybody says, oh, this came out of nowhere. Actually, it didn't. The Liberal government has been talking about banning guns since 2015, since they came into power. The problem was, is there wasn't a big appetite for it. Canadians didn't have it as you know, a checkbox on their list of election issues. They just didn't care about it. You know, if the question is, should we ban guns from legal owners? It's like, meh, probably not. You know, there was no hunger for it. But when you had the Nova Scotia tragedy happen, of course, you have an entire country mourning this horrific, like just unbelievable thing that happened in this tiny community of good, solid, salt of the earth people, right? And it was so shocking, and it literally put Canadians into shock. I mean, there was, you know, TV programs and memorials, and it went on and on because everybody just could not believe what happened. And even to this day, we're still finding out more and more about the case. But in any event, that was the time to strike because Canadians were sensitive. Canadians were mourning. Canadians were maybe a little more open to such a huge strategic move. And at the same time, we know that he pulls in gun control whenever he needs that channel changer. And things have not been going well for him, right, with all his scandals. So interestingly enough, they do the ban on May 1. And shortly afterwards, Bill Blair appeared on CTV with Evan Solomon. And Evan asked him, you know, would this ban have stopped the Nova Scotia shooter? Would it have stopped that tragedy? And Bill Blair said yes. And I remember at the time, of course, at that time when it aired, we did not know the source of Wortman's guns. We didn't know if he was a licensed gun owner. We didn't know these things. So we were thinking like, oh my God, he must have been a licensed gun owner with legal firearms. Like, this is insane, right? So this is what it leads you to believe, which of course is completely false. And Bill Blair and Justin Trudeau knew it. Now imagine just for a moment, close your eyes and imagine Bill Blair saying those words to Evan Solomon on national TV. And imagine you are a person in Nova Scotia who lost someone that you love in that tragedy. Number one, if there was something this government could have done to stop that tragedy, which you can't read minds, but if there was something that could have been done and they didn't, then they failed all those people, number one. And number two, now that we know the truth, now that we know that Justin Trudeau and Bill Blair knew that those guns were all illegally acquired firearms and he was not a licensed gun owner, it was an outright lie. They used those victims and that tragedy to prop up a gun ban that nobody wanted. And to me, that is an absolute travesty.
Yeah. Well, Bill Blair is a congenital liar. You know, I'm not even sure he knows when he's lying anymore. He's told so many lies. It's really horrible because, you know, one of the episodes that's coming up on Gun Ban Canada Exposed is called "The System is Broken." And, you know, as I said before, these episodes are killing me. There's so much research involved and everything else. Right. But, you know, that's a perfect example. Like, you can go out there, you can lie in the House of Commons, you can lie on TV, you can lie to people's faces as Bill Blair did to us. Mm-hmm. And it's just like, yeah, that's okay. It's okay. And it's okay with the anti-gun folks as long as they win. You know, like lying and...
I don't know, man. I don't know how people can just live like that. I don't understand it. Yeah. I think without integrity, you have nothing. And yes, if there are things that we can do, you know, to try and stop or intervene in tragedies like this, should we do it? Of course. You know, there's all kinds of interesting things coming out of there about failures from law enforcement to, you know, to follow up on reports. And, you know, hindsight is always 20/20. It's easy to look in the rearview mirror and see what you've done wrong. I mean, we're all human. But at the same time, to play on people like that, just to gain support for your political agenda, to me, I don't know, man, that's, mm-hmm. It's so twisted that I almost have a hard time even, like, it literally keeps me up at night. I can't believe these people run this country.
Yeah. It's, that's just a day's work in their eyes. They don't even feel that at all. I mean, again, I don't know that because I can't read, you know, Mr. Blair's mind, but it must be just a mess in there anyway. Yeah. But yeah, they knew all about it and they lied and, just, this is no way to run a country and, it's not bringing us together. It's tearing us apart. Yeah, anyway, I guess along the lines of this highly depressing conversation that we're having, we won't spend too much time talking about this, but, you know, as an extension of that conversation, I mean, you look at what happened in Toronto, right? That 12-year-old boy was killed because, you know, Bill Blair with his gun bans and all the rest of his, you know, his monkey business has done nothing to stop the violence in Toronto. And it's continued to go on unabated. And it actually cost a little boy his life. And, you know, this is what we're complaining about. This is what we're trying to refocus. All the anti-gun people were like, refocus on what the problem is. These aren't gun owners. They don't hang out at the gun club and then go shoot each other at nightclubs at night. You know, we need to stop the violence. And they're like, nope, we want a gun ban and we want you guys silenced and we want your group destroyed and, you know, we want you hurt. And it's like, they just won't have it. And this is, I don't want to be them. So I won't draw a direct line by saying, his blood is on your hands, because I think that's, you know, I'm just as subject to being emotional and frustrated and saying things as anybody else. I'm just a normal person, but you know, I'm not going to say that directly, but that lack of focus on the real problems may have contributed to that situation occurring where the criminals are still so bold, they don't give a crap. And they got full autos too, by the way. Mm-hmm. Those have been prohibited since 1977. So I don't know where those came from. Probably not a straw buyer there. But, you know, there is a little bit of connection between, you know, this misdirection about gun bans and what happened there.
Oh, I wouldn't even say there's a little bit. I would say I actually say it all the time. It's the same line I use all the time. There is a cost to ignoring crime and violence and focusing instead on legal owners. And there's a cost to it. And it can be measured in human lives. And this is a perfect example of that. While we're all, you know, sitting here fighting back and forth about keep your AR or take this one or take that one or, you know, messing around with rules and, oh, well, you should, you know, register your purchases and all this baloney and noise. And, you know, at the same time, there's a 12-year-old kid walking home from the grocery store with his mom who's lost his life. You know, where's the worry about him, right? It's frustrating because, you know, we're both parents and that terrifies me. I can't even imagine, you know, how that mom felt. And I don't know. It's awful. We have to change this conversation. And, you know, Pete Merrifield, or I think it was actually the president of the National Police Federation, he was asked what's got them really riled up and speaking out lately. And he says it was, you know, aside from the Nova Scotia shooting, it was this 12-year-old kid dying. The president of the National Police Federation said that. He says, that's it. We've got to stop fooling around, chasing around legal gun owners, and we've got to start focusing on the real problem. Our kids are literally dying. So, you know, I sometimes feel hyperbolic when I think like that. You know, I think maybe I'm just being hysterical, but no, law enforcement is saying the exact same thing. And they're the experts here. They're the front line. So we either start listening to them or all is lost.
No, that's well said. That's well said. I agree. Mm-hmm. Anyway, that's enough of that depressing stuff. Do you have anything good to talk about?
I do, actually. Let's talk about girls and guns. So as you know, we've got the 2021 CCFR Gunny Girl calendar for sale online. This is a really fun project. I always say that because it truly, truly is. These are real girls, you know, from all across the country. We bring them all together. We have a great retreat weekend. We have a ton of fun, sit around the campfire. I cook them all kinds of goodies. And it's a lot of camaraderie and friendship. And the ladies love it. At the same time, we also do these amazing photo shoots. We dress them up. We shine them up. And it's just a good time all around. Anyways, we put together a calendar every year. And I have to say, this year is probably my favorite year for this calendar. It is selling like hotcakes. We are over 60% sold out. And we've got a calendar signing tour coming up on December 5th. So this is sort of in the GTA area. We will be on Saturday, December 5th. We will have a whole gaggle of CCFR Gunny Girls with us. We will have calendars for sale. If you've already brought one, bring it in, bring it with you. We will be at Select Shooting Supplies in Cambridge from 1 until 2 p.m. come on in, say hi to the girls. We're going to have them all there. You can get your picture taken, say hi. You can buy a calendar. You can shop at the store, whatever you want to do. It's going to be a great fun. Then we're going to be moving on in the afternoon between 4 and 5 p.m. We'll be at Bullseye North. We're going to go see the gang there. It's the same kind of deal. If you've already bought your calendars, bring them in. We'll get the girls to autograph them. You can get some pictures with the ladies. If you haven't got a calendar, pick one up at that time. And, of course, support your local stores. There will also be some details coming out about a calendar signing at SFRC in Kingston on December 12th. I just don't have a time for that yet, but stay tuned to the CCFR social media. We'll make sure we'll bring all of that to you.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Well, that's positive.
It's going to be fun. These girls are a hoot, actually. There's so many fun stories and just shenanigans that go on behind the scenes when we do this calendar. And, just sometimes you're looking at one, you're like, take your shoes off, put it on the other one. And it's just hilarious how these girls help each other out, support each other, prop each other up. And, they've grown to be good friends. In fact, we have a group on Facebook that year after year, we add the new calendar girls to it. And we call it the Gunny Girl Alumni. And, we do all kinds of events together. So, yeah, it's kind of great. It's like little sisterhood, women of the CCFR. So
awesome.
Yeah, it's great.
Outstanding. Well, if you want to buy a calendar, you can go on to the CCFR online store and get it there, correct?
That's correct. They're on sale for $20. And don't forget, they're for the first time in history, registration does not lead to confiscation. It leads to prizes because there is a registration number on the back
awesome.
Of the calendar. Yeah. You can go to ccfrcalendar.com, register that calendar after January 1st, and you will be in the draw for prizes all year long. So that $20 calendar isn't just a great way to support the women's program. It's also a great way to win stuff all year long.
Registration leads to prizes, not confiscation. You nailed it on that one, Wilson.
Yeah, for the first time in history. Yeah.
That's awesome. That's great. All right. Well, thanks for coming on, and we'll see you next time.
Sounds great. Talk soon.
All right, that's going to do it for episode 80 of the CCFR Radio podcast. Thanks, everyone, for listening. And don't forget to share the podcast. And don't forget to share episode 3 and 2 and 1 of Gun Ban Canada Exposed. It's all up to us to be our own organic search engine when it comes to our content. And we work really hard at the CCFR to produce it. No one's ever been able to do this kind of work. I know why, because I don't want to do it now either. But it is important work, and it has to get to the right people. And those people are the undecided. And it's up to you guys to do it. I do it in my own life. I try to get people to watch this kind of material, and then I talk to them about it after, right? We debate it or just explore it. So anyway, if you possibly can, spread this content around everywhere that you can. I mean, the ability for you to hold on to your guns in the future depends on it. So anyway, hopefully you enjoy it. Let me know what you think. If you want to become a member of the CCFR, we'd love it if you did that. You can do that by going over to firearmrights.ca. And also, don't forget to check out Christopher Balkran's The Strong and Free podcast. Great podcast, a lot of great subject matter, not all about guns. And give him a listen and share his stuff too. So really appreciate the opportunity to sit down and talk with Christopher. Other than that, thanks for listening, everyone, and we'll see you soon.
This is another episode of the CCFR Radio Podcast. Remember, if you don't stand up for your own ability to own and use firearms, who will? Join the CCFR or donate right now at www.firearmrights.ca.